Let's start looking at some of the individual functions in the DAX language. To start with, and probably the most common thing that you'll find yourself doing, we'll look at aggregating numeric values up, sum, average, max, min, that sort of thing. Then Alberto will walk through some more mathematical functions to do things like standard deviations and the like. We'll look at how you can use logical functions to control flow within your expressions, if then else those kind of statements. And finally, Alberto will look at some of the functionality around managing text and date time data.
When you author measures, and we will spend most of our time writing measures instead of calculated columns, you typically use aggregators. Aggregators are functions that compute some kind of aggregation over a set of values. So typically aggregators are sum to get the sum of something, average, as you might imagine, to get the average, mean, and max. Those functions have two limitations. The first one is that they only work on numeric columns. This somewhat makes sense. You cannot take the sum of a string. You cannot take the average of a string. You might want to take the minimum or the maximum of a string, but this simply does not work because this function have this behavior in Excel, and for compatibility with Excel, they have the same behavior in DAX. But that is not a strong limitation. You typically live well with that. There is another limitation which is much worse, and that is all these functions are able to aggregate a single column. You can easily compute the sum of sales amount or the sum or order price or whatever column you want to aggregate. But if you want to do the aggregation of price multiplied by quantity, that simply does not work. You cannot do that using sum. And that's a much worse limitation because a lot of times, imagine you want to compute a weighted average, you want to compute whatever kind of calculation you might want to prepare, then you might be in trouble because you cannot aggregate expressions. You can solve this in two ways. The first one is create a calculated column that multiplies order by quantity, and then you use sum to aggregate it. But this means that you create a calculated column, and we learned that calculated columns are bad, so we don't want to create a calculated column. The other option is to get rid of these aggregators and instead use one of the X aggregators. The X aggregators have nearly the same name of the standard aggregators, just with an X at the end. And I typically call them aggregators or iterators because this is what they do. The X aggregators receive always two parameters. The first one is a table, and the second one is an expression. And then they iterate row by row on the table and compute the expression. As an example, look at total sales computed in this way. And by the way, if you want, you can, we can write it on the demo machine. So we try writing a sum with an aggregator. Demo machine. Okay, here we are. Okay, we can create a new measure that computes the sum of sales amount, but instead of computing it with the column, it computes as a standard measure. So we simply go there, create a measure, and we need to use a different name. On the slide, I called it total sales, which is fine. And total sales uses sumx. Sumx is an iterator, so it requires two parameters. The first one is the table that you want to iterate. In this case, it's sales. Let me zoom in a bit so we can read better. And then for each row in the sales, we compute sales quantity multiplied by sales net price. This calculation will iterate row by row on the sales table, and for each row, compute quantity multiplied by price. Okay? A very quick question for you. Do I have a current row when I'm here evaluating this expression? Let's make it simple. Who says no? Who says yes? So few people. I have first of all, I need to have a current row because if I didn't have a current row, I could not retrieve the value of sales quantity. So a current row need to be there. The point is only understanding who provided that current row. And the current row is provided by SumX. SumX is an iterator, so it goes on the first line of sales and computes the value, then goes on the second line and computes the value. And this happens row by row for all the rows in the sales table, no matter how many hundreds of millions are there. So I have a current row, and I typically say that I have, here I refer to the quantity value in the sales table for the currently iterated row by SumX over sales. Make sense? Yep.
And if you want to multiply times a column from a different table?
That is coming in a few seconds.
Okay.
There was somebody there ready to die for starvation because you raised your hand while he was much more direct.
Okay.
So, if you hit enter at this point, we create the measure. The measure cannot be visible here, but we can put it on the report. Under sales, we have it somewhere. Here it is, total sales. You click on total sales, and you get, as a result, total sales. Now, this sales amount probably was multiplied by something different. Here I use the net price, while here on sales amount, I use unit price. Now, it's easier to modify the measure. So go to total sales and use unit price. Just to make sure that the numbers we are computing are correct. And now the two numbers should be the same, 117 and 117, at least. For this calculation, everything is simple. Now, in this case, using an iterator, we are able to compute total sales without having the need to create a calculated column. That means if we want, and if we are very precise, we can simply kill this sales amount column because basically we don't need it. We don't need to have a calculated column if all we want to do is perform an iteration over a table or aggregate some kind of expression. We need to run through a set of functions. I'm going to run this part very, very fast so we save more time for later. Just because I want to show you very quickly the set of functions that are available. You have function to count values. They are coming again from the Excel experience. You have count that only counts numeric columns, and then you have count A that counts anything, but it forgets about counting blanks. And then you have count blank that only counts the rows that contain a blank. A blank is the equivalent of a null or no value, so a column containing nothing at all. In my life, I think that I have never used count, count A, count blank. Because they simply count the number of values. Whereas there is count rows, which is much more interesting because count rows does not count the different values, but count the number of rows that exist inside a table. And it's very, very common to use. And then distinct count. If you look at them, there are the same kind of functionalities that you can get by using Power BI when you choose the aggregation that you want in a report. So either you choose the aggregation in Power BI using distinct count or count or simply count, or you create a measure that computes the value for you. Then there are logical functions, standard Boolean logic, like and, or, not, if, and if error. Keep in mind that in DAX, you can use a Boolean logic in two ways. You can use the standard Excel syntax, and, AB, or you can use the double ampersand, which is the logical and in a more C-sharp-like. In C-sharp and in modern programming language, they use the double ampersand for AND, the double pipe for OR, and the exclamation mark for NOT. At the beginning, I typically was using the double ampersand because it made me feel much cooler. Oh, I'm a developer of C-sharp, I'm not an Excel coder. Over time, I started forgetting about this as an operator, and I started using the functions instead. Because they tend to make the code easier to read if your formula is a very complex one, provided that you intend the code in the right way. The only limitation of the function is that you can only pass two parameters. And so if you have AND of three parameters, you end up having AND, and the code becomes much harder to read. Then there are information functions. Information functions provide you information about the expression you want to test. So if you want to check whether a measure is a blank, sorry? Yeah? Louder. I'm getting older, so I no longer hear.
If you use the ampersand sign, two ampersand
Yes? So if you use the ampersand, I typically need to repeat the question because they are recording and otherwise they don't hear you. If you use the ampersand, you can put many, many conditions one after the other in a logical and in a very easy way. So that's the only reason why ampersand, the double ampersand or the double pipe are useful. But if the condition is a very simple one, it's totally fine to use them. If the conditions start to be very complex, then formatting the code becomes much harder with the operators. Then there is a set of information function that tells you whether an expression is a blank, is a number, is text, is non-text, or is an error. Is error is somewhat useful because it tells you whether an expression that you provide as a parameter returns an error or not. All the other ones are useful in case you don't know the data type of your columns. And you already know what I think about people not knowing the data type of columns. So these functions are there, but they are not really useful. And I think that I have never used them in my entire career. Then there is max and min. They introduced a beautiful feature, well, beautiful, a very useful feature in SQL in 2015, that is the opportunity of computing the max, using max to calculate the maximum of a column. But if you pass two parameters to max, then you can take the maximum of two values. You can always get the same using an if statement. If A is greater than B, then return me A, otherwise return B. But that is turns out to be a bit more complex and a bit harder to read and write, whereas max and min are much, much more simple to use. If you are used to Power BI, now, going back to Excel, to DAX, we have a lot of mathematical functions. I'm not going to explain you how the logarithm or the square root work. These are the kind of functions that when you need them, you use them and they work exactly as you expect. There's nothing strange and nothing complex about them. There is a function which is extremely useful, which is divide. You know that whenever you divide one number by another one, division by a zero might happen. And so you typically use a pattern that says, if the column that I want is greater or different than zero, then perform the division, otherwise return zero, a default value, or whatever, a blank, or whatever you prefer. If you avoid this if statement, good chances are that this will lead to an error. And remember that errors are the evil for performances of DAX. Divide is an easy way to perform the same division without having the if statement. And writing, by the way, this that can be a very complex expression only once, because divide tries the division, and if any error happens, then it returns the default value instead of returning the standard one. And then we have a set of text functions, which I'm not gonna again explain as I did them before, because I'm not going to explain you how replace, search, upper value do. Value computes a value, concatenates, simply concatenates two strings, and is the very same as the ampersand, and so on. They are very similar to Excel ones, and if you need them, you simply use them to compute the values that you might want to compute. And then there is a set of date functions that at the beginning look very useful, because you can extract the date, get the value of a date, get the end of month, extract hours, minutes, seconds, or sum values to dates and do calculation like those. These functions look useful at the beginning because people tend to think that time intelligence can be done using these calculations. So if I want to compare the sales of the current year against the sales of the previous year, or the current month with the same month in the previous year, you can use these functionalities. In reality, time intelligence is done in a totally different way, and we will see that this afternoon. So these functions have some limited usage. I don't remember having used many of them apart extracting parts from a date, the day, the month name, or values like those. So again, I want just to show you that they are there, but then you can, when you need them, you Google or you Bing for them, and then you search for whatever, for syntax and stuff like that.